morning, everybody. I'm Martin Lopez. I will present a paper which you wrote today. It's Aki van Pes, my colleague from Holland. It is about using Space Syntax as a consultancy tool. I will describe a project that we undertook for 2 years, and that is called Social Safe Urban Design. I've used that as an example to describe the possibilities for Space Syntax as a consultancy tool, and the challenges that you will meet when you use that in regenerating urban areas. The project Social Safe Urban Design was a 2-year effort aiming to develop new knowledge about the spatial structure of the built environment and crime, and the number and dispersal of crime, to transfer that knowledge to practitioners and to apply practical urban design solutions. So we really wanted to implement some new measures in these neighborhoods. The project design consisted of 4 phases. Well, we started with a research question. Holland has got many neighborhoods that are very safe. There are no or little problems. There are some that have a few problems, and we have a list of 40 neighborhoods, which are now called priority neighborhoods. Some people call it problem areas, because there is a lot of problems with crime. So we wondered, is there a difference between these problem areas and areas that have the same type of residents, that have the same size and the same building pyramid? And we started with a quick and dirty research to test this question. We took about 7 of those areas, compared them to 4 others, and the first impression, the preliminary outcome was from yes, space does matter. Then we started the real research, and a big inquiry in 43 neighborhoods. Most of them were problem areas, and we had about 7 neighborhoods that were comparable in terms of social, economic, and demographic composition. And we looked at the spatial characteristics, the degree of crime and disorder. The results of this study are presented tomorrow by Aki van Pes. We took 8 neighborhoods as pilot studies. We talked to the municipalities that also funded this research, this project. And there we did an in-depth study of space and crime. And we looked not only at the microscale level, so not only at the space syntax variables that can be calculated, but also to the microscale, to the buildings, to the visibility, and to the character of that neighborhood. The last phase was consultancy, giving advices to those developing, designing partners, organized local workshops in which we presented our results. We came with some scenarios. We showed them, this is your area. You can change it in that way. But the key question was, is it feasible? Can we use these models and translate them to measures that are not only effective, but it is also possible to carry those out. If you want to apply Space Syntax as a consultancy tool, and you want the measures to really be implemented, you need to make sure that you involve the stakeholders, the parties involved. For this, we used many different approaches. The first approach was a communicative approach. We went to talk with those people and we asked them what the key issues for them were in these neighborhoods. I think this is very important that you don't go to those people and tell them, we have a tool, please use it. And we think that the question is that no. Those people work with their neighborhoods to design it or to redesign it. And they're struggling with a few key issues. So first you talk with them, identify them, and then try to incorporate it in your project. Another thing is that you must use acceptable and understandable terms. When you use space syntax terminology, that is quite technical. It is useful for the space syntax community, but stakeholders, people who are working with neighborhoods, don't know what local integration is, and they don't know what local angular integration with a high and a low metric pages is. So translate those to common words that are understandable to these people. And also involve them in the process. Give them ownership. So the measures that are invented, that are not your proposals, but that are their proposals as well. And when you don't do this, you have a higher chance that the measures will actually be implemented. And of course we have the top-down approach, the analysis, space syntax, a lot of field work we have done, and making those improvement scenarios. The conceptual framework, so translating those technical space syntax terms to normal words that are used by those stakeholders. We had five criteria, five concepts: accessibility, connectedness, and vitality. That is all related to the structure of the street segment, and it can be calculated through space index. Visibility, identity, that is about the arrangement of the object in the built environment, and you can get data on that by observations, by field work. We will look at this, accessibility. That is another word for what you will call global and local integration. But when you talk to laymen and you talk about integration, they will think about social integration. Mixing different types of people and integrating them. So don't use this word. We were trying to use that word, and that worked. So accessibility is how easy is it for you to get somewhere, and how likely is it to encounter other people. Our working thesis was that more people on the street, you will get more eyes on the street and more social control. The next one is connectedness. That is a step-up analysis from the main roots. You can use the local angular analysis to identify the main road network. And then you calculate the number of topological steps that the street is away from the main route. We have done some studies about this before, and the finding was always that this really matters for crime. The further away from the main route, the higher the chance of burglary, vandalism, and violence. Vitality, that is also something you can calculate with a space index. When you calculate the local angular integration with a low metric values, you will pinpoint the places where you will find vital street life. You can also take the high metric radius, and those places are suited for local, small local businesses. That is also an outcome of other spaces index studies. So we were looking for the spatial potential for vital street life and successful local businesses. And we found the most successful, as opposed to areas, successful in terms of livability, in safety, are those neighborhoods that have a central main route that have an overlap of the spatial potentials for local street life and local businesses. So this is also a very powerful concept. Visibility. It is important for people that they see other people, that they know what is going on, and that they know, that they feel, that others can see them as well. So to see and to be seen. Of course, the former criteria, accessibility, connectedness, and vitality are very important for visibility. Of course, that is bringing people to the street. But also the inter-visibility of windows, which is a micro-scale thing. So looking at the windows of buildings, visual barriers and those things are important for visibility. So how easy is it to see other people? Visibility is a combination of macro and micro-scale properties of space. Identity, that is about the character and the atmosphere of a neighborhood. So how attractive is a neighborhood? How clear are the spatial functions? And how intelligible is the root system? For most people, it is clear at one glance what the function of a space is and who owns it. And you see what a park is, what a front garden is, what a park is. And people tend to know, to feel, who owns that place, who's taking care of it. But there are also spaces in cities where the function and the ownership is less clear. And in the most extreme cases, those places are very unsafe places that are pieces of no man's land that law-abiding residents tend to avoid. So that is very important. Well, we've done the research. The general findings are there are strong correlation between spatial characteristics and criminal dispersal. Different types of crime occur in different types of space, which has also been shown before by Alfred and by other researchers. And there's a strong correlation between the social safety, part of street life, and the potential for small businesses. This is all stuff which is very well suited for a space index symposium or for research papers. But for a stakeholder who wants to change his neighborhood, he say, okay, give me some design guidelines. Tell me how I can make my neighborhood a better place. So we have looked at a more practical way as well and looked for guidelines. We found many, but I will just mention two. That is that the main route must go through the neighborhood and not around it. The special conditions for street life and local businesses is important, so put your things at the right place. The orientation of buildings, very important. And creating places for meeting and interaction. When you do these things, you will create vital and safe communities. The first one. Here are the pictures of four of the eight pilot cases, and you see that in most cases the main routes go outside of the neighborhood. This is keeping the people outside the neighborhood. These places are only visited by residents, and that doesn't contribute to an integration of these neighborhoods in more connectedness. I've only 5 minutes, so I will go a bit fast. The condition for street life is important, I've already mentioned it. The orientation of buildings. very important. You see more and more and more that buildings are, in some cases, turned away from the street. That is creating a sense of privacy for the residents, but for social control, that is not a good thing. Media and interaction. Public space is not only used for movements. Yesterday there was a presentation from a man who showed us how to calculate an optimum network for movement. But public space is more. It's also a space where people meet other people, where children play, where you chat with your neighbor, and where you meet people that you've never met before. That is a very important function of open space. So playgrounds, squares, avenues that are the icing on the cake in neighborhoods. Make those places the focal point of this social activity and put your businesses, communities at the right place. When you do that, you can create a space for meeting and interaction. We had eight pilot cases. And I'll give you some examples of the measures that are proposed in three of them. The first is Wildorf in the city of Deventer, which is a very, well, old, it's a pure neighborhood consisting of three parks. In the north park is a park that's called Oudenstad. Here's another park, and the central park, that's also called the social problems are present over here. We have looked at the possibilities to improve this neighborhood, and we have found a couple of them. I think I'm running out of time. One of the most important things was that the main route is outside the neighborhood. There was a strong road over here, methods, but that has changed by the end of traffic engineers. They have limited the accessibility at this point, so all the shops have transferred to our streets, and this street was a bit dying. The second is Banana Island in Utrecht, which is maybe the most unsafe area in Holland. It's a modernistic neighborhood. And we have a big problem there. It's very big. And they say, we've got a lot of social problems, a lot of crime problems here. It can have something to do with this spatial configuration, but you can only make small changes because the spatial configuration is regarded as a monument of modernist design. So our analysis was showing that this neighborhood has low values on almost every variable that we measure. So it is really, really bad. We also looked at the structure and we found that the structure, how it was originally planned, when I get the structure, was using was acting very well, but later on traffic engineers changed them a bit and they cut the infrastructure at some places, and therefore the spatial structure was in a sense destroyed. So we did look for possibilities to make new connections in that neighborhood. The last one is a new neighborhood, which is called Kronemeer, part of which is built and the north part is still being planned. The spatial configuration is okay, but the accessibility is very low. And when you look at the micro scale, when you look at the connectedness, there are also some things of improvement. But the main thing is that in the middle, there is a lot of potential for street life, a lot of potential for businesses, but at this time you only have this, the traffic square. So our proposal was from don't use this road as a through road, but as a place for a shopping center or a place where people can meet. So make this a place that will not separate the two boroughs, but integrate them. The challenges that we are facing, well, there are quite a few. So first, translate the technical space syntax terms in words that are understandable for the layman, for the developing parties and the designing parties. And the other one is that creating lively, vibrant and safe communities is not always the first priority of the stakeholders. They always have agendas, they always have issues that they want to deal with. And for example, in Holland, the power of the traffic engineer is very, very strong. They want to create neighborhoods that are traffic safe. But the requirements for traffic safety are quite different than what we want to see. They try to make neighborhoods as low accessible as possible. They try to split all polygons of transportation. So pedestrians go this route, bicycles and other route, and cars, well, if possible, outside the neighborhood. This is creating traffic safe neighborhoods where nobody comes, only residents are in the street, so they are quite dead. Another thing is that developers will want to maximize profit on the short term. You can make very nice urban design plans, but then the developer will step in and he will say, okay, if I turn the building away from the main route, I can sell my property at a higher value. Because people want to live in a city, and at the same time they want to have the feeling of privacy. And this is a big problem for new urbanist areas that are built right now. They are built from a sense of privacy, but they are not built from the perspective of the people that are living there. They will be dead. People have a beautiful house, but when you visit those places, they have no places to meet, no places to shop, because they are very far outside with a car. And in the street, you only see a few people. Well, thank you very much for your attention.
I have a written name, and first of all, I must describe my position. I think that the space syntax has something worthy. It is the possibility of solving solutions, and solving solutions in architecture and making architecture to improve. Things. I don't know whether you have thought of characterizing neighborhoods, what a neighborhood is, how a neighborhood can be separated from little worlds, how a neighborhood could be differentiated from a sector or an area, in the sense that the final product could make people happier and more and they could identify much closely with the place. Mm-hmm.
So your question is, because I
my question is, have you thought of the correlation between the spatial network, yep, and the social network?
Yes, he has that was a big part of our research. We've looked at the dispersal and the number of crime. We've looked at the spatial network, and we have looked at what type of people lived where. So in the second phase, the big national inquiry for the three neighborhoods, we put that in that calculation. And also in those pilot neighborhoods, we first looked for what type of people are living there, and where are those people living. That's in that.
The question is a bit linked to a concern that you raised, that is, in terms of how did you define the neighborhood? How did you identify this is one neighborhood?
Yeah, that was a problem.
You didn't mention about having the need for streets to go through.
Yeah.
And I was thinking if you have streets going through, wouldn't that divide the neighborhood and separate them into two smaller neighborhoods?
The boundaries, that was a problem, especially in the national inquiry. We were looking at those priority neighborhoods, and then I was trying to make a big database of social data, crime data, and other data, and we find out that the definition of the borders of a neighborhood was different for the police, the municipality, so it was difficult to find those borders, but we did a good try, I think. And in pilot cases, well, we talked to the municipalities, and they all paid for one or two neighborhoods. And yeah, in some cases, I'm thinking like Canale Eiland North is about three times bigger than the last thing from the Meer. So, what is exactly the definition of a neighborhood? That is an ambiguous question.
It's like one thing is what the Central Bureau of Statistics or municipality, they have like a separate border where the police were operating with others. So, and also sometimes some neighborhoods is like what is registered as a neighborhood, the borders. Sometimes you have two neighborhoods next to each other, but you have a main route to integrate them. Or you have one neighborhood and you have a route through to separate them from one another. So that is. The one thing is like the administrative or border from various authorities. Another thing is what the spatial reality is.
If it is already held, I have a sort of mathematical definition. If you have some similarity index which defines an area, whether it is the percentage of not count or whatever, which so distinguish an area for another, then you can see that where that similarity index changes, a neighborhood is changing.
Yeah. Okay.
And then, of course, there is a second part, which would be the correlation with the social structure.
Yeah,
that was the part you need just the number of for that particular area, you know, all the social economic data. So that's why.
True.
That was very, because we analyzed 56 neighborhoods in the national inquiry, but only 43 of them, the border were corresponding. So a lot of cases we had spatial analysis, but we could not connect it to the social data because of the problem.
Other questions? Okay, thank you all for your attention.